Hey everyone, my name is Bernard Cana. I'm the editor photographer of the website known as The Photo Pit. Over to my right, I have my friend Danny Mazzeo, who is editor photographer over the website known as The Threshold, and special guest joining us tonight, which I absolutely love and adore. We have the founder of the Blue Ridge Rock Festival Fan Zone, the man himself, Todd Stone. Hey Todd, how you doing?
What's up, people? What's up, Danny and Bernard? How y'all doing today?
Good.
We're here, good. Man. Happy to have you on board with us today.
Glad to be on board, man.
Awesome. So let's get to rolling. So when we last did our live stream, we finished on Saturday. We did a Saturday afternoon one. So we're only able to get, you know, up to two more at that point. And then we still had another one that dropped that night on Saturday. Then on Sunday, we had three more. And then today, we had two more. So our goal today is we're going to cover all of those announcements that happened to give everyone an update on who they were. We're going to give you our thoughts behind those artists. And we'll go into discussing, you know, whatever else we got going on, depending how long we take to get through the rest of this stuff. And let me call out one point. First of all, yes, I have done laundry, just so you're aware. And number two, no, this is not a hint, but this is one of my favorite bands that I just absolutely love in this moment. So
not, I want not to, a hint either.
No,
just, Foo Fighters, just trying to be fashionable. Either,
so we're just
trying to be fashionable.
Or is it? Just saying. Any case, I told Danny, like, I'm going to start random rumors about bands that are coming in. So, you know, don't mind me. I'm just a troublemaker.
Oh, you're good. Last year I put out a fake flyer and everybody went with it. And none of the bands are on. Like, oh, yeah, it's great, man. I love it. It's great. I love it.
Well, we were hoping that we would get enough of a following by doing this live stream, that when Bernard and I do an acoustic set on the main stage to close out the festival, that the whole world just knows who we are.
That's hilarious. I can't
terrible.
Play a lick of an instrument whatsoever.
Oh, it would be absolutely terrible.
I can sing. I have some chops. I will say that. I can sing, but no, not play, but I can sing. You know, karaoke is my jam. So, you know, Anyway, so let's
kick this thing off. All right,
what are we doing?
We're already behind. Let's kick this thing off.
Why, people? Why do we do this to ourselves?
Come on, what band are you talking about? I can't remember hardly any announcements. Some flood so fast, like I don't want to say the wrong ones. You know, it's like
just follow our lead, and if we were wrong, and you happen to confirm something, people might like that.
All right,
let's not do that. We will apologize, John, if that happens. So it's not our intention. So, but anyway, follow my lead. I got all the ones we actually do get announced confirmed. So let's kick us off. All right, so we're going to start off with Saturday evening's one. I will tell you this right off the bat. I got psyched when I saw this announcement. Why? Number one, this band is I define them as hard rock. Some people may lean into them as kind of heavy metal. They're out of Wilmington, North Carolina. They formed in the late 90s, but I have this suspicion that a lot of people may not know who they are. They've probably heard of them, but may not have seen them. And if you haven't seen them, you are seriously missing out, because I love their sound. I love their style. And the best thing I love about these guys, it's the intensity of this band. The band I am talking about is known as He Is Legend. And when I saw this drop on Saturday night, I was so stoked. I've seen them many a time. I absolutely adore them. I think it's like, this is just, you know, a fantastic pick for the fest. So let me just run some quick notes on them, right? So I mentioned that they were, you know, they came around in the late 90s. They ended up getting their name, He Is Legend, dropped that in 2003 after they finally decided what they wanted to do. But when it comes to their discography, it's actually fairly large, at least to me. So in 2004, they came out with their first album, was known as I Am Hollywood. 2006 came out with Suck Out the Poison. That actually made it onto the Billboard 200 at number 158. It Hates You came out in 2009. That made it up to 126. 2014 was Heavy Fruit. That made it onto 148 onto the US Billboard 200. And then 2017 was an album called Few. That actually made it up to 170 at its peak. And then their most recent album was White Bat, and that came out in 2019. And apparently, according to the artist announcement, they are working on another album, hopefully this year, to drop. They do have two EPs. In 2004 was an EP called 91025, and then in 2006 was an EP called Black Unicorn Split. I mean, but this is, he is legend. I mean, this is the lead vocalist. His name is Shiloh Karum. And if you have not heard this guy sing, he's a must. He's a must. I mean, this is, yeah, I'm keen. I love this. I absolutely love it. Great pick. Absolutely great pick. Dan, what you got for me on this one? Anything? Nothing?
Yet again, really hard to follow when you do something like that. But honestly, right. I'm on the other side of the spectrum. This is a band that I've heard the name thrown around more than I care to admit. And it was one of those, I don't know who they are, couldn't tell you. And so I never gave them the time of day. This announcement dropped on what was it, I guess, Saturday.
Saturday night.
And, you know, all these days are blending together. So that they drop on Saturday. I immediately added them to the playlist, added them on Spotify, and now I'm hooked. I couldn't tell you the names of their songs. I definitely couldn't run through their discography. But when you reference the guy's voice, I mean, it's on point. It is on point. And this hard rock, near metal sound that they're carrying, I'm really excited about them. And I think this also hammers home kind of what we've been saying in each one of these live streams, is this is the time to get to know a whole bunch of new music. And this is definitely one that's hitting the rotation.
Yep. What about you, Todd? Are you a fan of them?
I'd be honest, first time I've heard of them is when I seen them on the lineup. Yeah, they're on my rotation now. Definitely on my workout rotation. Yeah, they're heavy. I call them heavy. The lead singer, right, is just amazing. His voice is shattering. They're going to be one of my must-sees if I get a chance with the lineup, as y'all know. Anyway, yeah, I'm on board. I'm on board with y'all on that one for sure.
All right. Yeah, I agree. I would say, you know, for anyone who's, when you come to Blue Ridge, if you had it, unfortunately, when you got to pick, you know, your selections of what bands you want to see, I would say put them on it for sure. Yeah, I love these guys. Absolutely. Yeah. And Danny, you should be ashamed of yourself, because aren't they out of your area?
North Carolina is a big state. All right.
I'm just saying.
But yes, I should be. I'm also not necessarily so North bad. Carolina. I'm also New York. I'm also Virginia. You know, I'm everywhere, man.
I know. I'm just picking on you.
But they know, just like all of your Florida favorites, Virginia is the place to go.
Yes. but it's funny. That's a nice little lead-in. So let's talk about what happened on Sunday. It's funny that you mentioned that, because the first band that got announced on Sunday is from Richmond, Virginia. This band has been around, I'll use the word forever. I mean, it really is not, well, maybe it is. I guess it is. Because they were around, they started in 2001. So we're talking about 21 years that this band's been around. They are thrash. And I will admit, I have heard of them like for the longest time. I have only just recently seen them when they were touring with the Circle Jerks. And I absolutely loved them. And I would not pass an opportunity to see these guys. So the band that I'm discussing here, that's up next on the announcement from Sunday morning, was Municipal Waste. And I was like, okay, we're now going back, you know, from this one side of variety of metal to now yet a little bit of a heavier side of metal. And I'll tell you this, these guys on stage are crazy. I mean, literally, they're fun, they're energetic, and they're just a thrill. So let me go through a little bit of stuff about them. So they formed in Richmond, Virginia around 2000 or so. You know, they're considered very much crossover thrash bands. Crossover thrash is what they listed them as. I mean, to me, they're thrash. I mean, how many genres of thrash are there? That's just my opinion. you know, they did have a lot of, they said like Suicidal Tendencies, it was like one of their biggest like musical influences, you know, around that style and form. And it fits them very well. If you've never seen them, it fits them very well. Their discography is pretty sizable. Waste 'Em All in 2003 was their first album. They were under 6 Weeks Record. That was the label at that time. Hazardous Mutation came out in 2005. The Art of Partying in 2007. And that's a great album, by the way. Massive Aggressive in 2009. They then signed to Nuclear Blast, right? Didn't we not just talk about that label the other day?
Just raving about that, right? That company, yeah.
For those of you who don't know, Nuclear Blast Records has this such a fantastic arrangement of metal on their label. Like, just go look at their lineup of bands that are signed to them. It's just so good. It's so good. The Fatal Feast was in 2012. And then Slime and Punishment, another great album, by the way, came out in 2017. Now, they had a couple of EPs, and one of them was recent. 2001 was their self-titled EP called Municipal Waste. Then they had Scion Presents Municipal Waste in 2012. And I kind of feel like that was another label, like, I don't want to say it was like maybe re-representing or re-announcing this band to get more fans to, you know, just the way it was like listed as, like Scion Presents. And that was the name of the label they were at that time. Garbage Pack came out in 2012. And the most recent, you know, part of music they had was in 2019. That was called The Last Rager, and that came out of Nuclear Blast Records. So yeah, I like this. They're a great band. Good pick for them. Good pick for Blue Ridge. Excellent. Danny, you know these guys or no?
I do know these guys. I wouldn't say that I'm intimately familiar as I am with some of the other bands, but I definitely know these guys. I did not pick up on any of the clues from the fan zone, so well done. But how much can you really say about thrash other than this is going to be a fun set, just hands down. And I have not seen them, so I'm definitely pumped on them. And hopefully my dog in the background is not getting too rambunctious with you guys tonight.
Whatever. We're fine. It's live. We're good. Todd, what about you with Municipal?
Honest to truth, not one of my favorite picks, but it's a festival. Not one of my things. Thrasher's great, but I outgrew it years ago. But like you said, they put on a good show, I'm sure. Hit it. Not on that spectrum for me, though. I'll be somewhere else on that one.
That's perfectly fair. Perfectly fair. I've said the same about some other bands we've already talked about, so that's all good. All right, let's see. So I'm making our way through Sunday. This next one, come on. I don't want to say I'm on the fence about this one, but I'm a little like, I don't know, like, I think I'm a little mixed emotion about this one. So once again, this is Blue Ridge showing like going back and finding artists that are, you know, still active, who maybe not be in the forefront of like everyone's vision right now when it comes to, you know, Spotify playlists, you know, music videos and whatnot, but bands that are still active that you should remember and know. And some people I think have a lot of nostalgia for these artists too. And I kind of feel like that's what this is. So this was the Sunday afternoon pick. They're listed as a heavy metal band, but I don't define them that way because I think the real description of it, and you guys can argue with me if this is true or not, I think this band is more industrial metal. No, it's not Nine Inch Nails. Sorry, people. They came out in 1989 out of Los Angeles, but the band that we're talking about is Fear Factory. So Fear Factory, I'm like, my gosh, like these guys, you know, have been around like forever and a day. I'd be like, unless you're like, you know, you're born in the 90s, maybe you might not know them, but even if you were, you probably still have heard of them at least one time if you follow metal in any way, shape, or form. I mean, but their discography is massive. They have 10 studio albums that they released. Actually, find them here. That would be great. Thank you. The first album came out in 92, which was The Soul of a New Machine. Demanufacture came out in 95, Obsolete in 98. Digimortal in 2001, Archetype in 2004, Transgression, that's a great album, by the way, in 2005. But then they had a really big gap. It wasn't until another 5 years later where they came out with their next album, which was Mechanized, and that was in 2010. 2012 was The Industrialist, Genexus in 2015, and then their most recent album that they dropped just last year was called Aggression Continuum. And I think the reason I'm a little mixed emotion about this is that it is like a nostalgia band. And I guess Fear Factory to me is not someone I would have put in like my sights right now, like to go see. Like if they're on stage in comparison to other bands, I may go pick somebody else over Fear Factory, but I don't know. That's just my take. Danny?
I'm glad to disagree with you on this one.
Good. Bernard. Somebody disagree with me.
and apparently quite a few of our viewers are all about some Fear Factory too. So for one, Dino, right? Dude's got talent.
Never said he didn't.
I know, but I think for me, now I've seen Fear Factory 3 times in the last 2 decades. So they've obviously evolved. They continue to evolve. They're I don't know. It, more than a nostalgia, I think it's also from knowing how many bands that they have influenced. And I do agree that Fear Factory was very much on the cutting edge of defining industrial metal. And that, to me, that sound is just, to me, that's just an adrenaline rush waiting to happen. So I went nuts when I saw that announcement, because this is definitely one I'm looking forward to. Okay. Now, where does Todd stand? That's the real.
Let's be the Todd. Todd could be the tiebreaker.
Industrial metal all the way, man. Yeah, they're totally. When they got on board with this Static X, Fear Factor, Dope, Mushroom Head tour, I bought the tickets. Fear Factor wasn't the main reason, but I was glad they're there. They're one of my all-time favorites. Just industrial metal through and through for old guys, I guess you could say. Just really started it all with, you know, the Static X, the Dope, the Fear Factor. Metal, Nine Inch Nails started it all, but you know what I understand. But Fear Factor was a complete surprise. He kept that for me for a long time because he told me that Static X had go ahead and postponed everything. And went, oh, shit, we lost. Oops, sorry. Crap, we lost everybody. Sorry. We lost everybody, but we got Fear Factor. And I was really, really just stoked with that one. That was a good announcement for me on Sunday. So okay. I'm anxious to see him again.
All right. That's cool. So you are big. You said you're a big fan of the industrial. So what is it about industrial that you really like, Todd, compared to, like, you know, the other metal genres that are out there?
I'm not big on genres, but industrial, the Dope, the Static X, it spoke to me in my early days when I needed them. It was that garage, just whatever we could pick up and play. You know, I've met everybody from Dope. I've partied with everybody doing that genre. It's just really nostalgic to me that they've got me through. All right, Dope, Die, Mother, Die. You could put that on and just let it blare, and you didn't have to go do that, but you could do it in your head. And it's just that grunt, just that hard-hitting
industrial. It's got that dirty sound to it that just hits.
There's, it's all just, it just feeds my soul for some reason. Some music does and some don't, but that one feeds my soul.
All right. No, that's cool. And this is why we have these, you know, I like to have multiple people on so we can talk about these. And
it's a festival. You don't like it, walk on. You'll find something on four other stages, I guarantee it.
plenty of opportunity to keep on walking.
That is true. Now I will say this, you know, I might not walk away from that. You know, it's just not my top pick of something I would choose. Like, if I had to make a choice between something or something else, you know, Fear Factory is not on the top of my list. That's all. Yeah. I got to be in a mood for industrial sometimes. I don't know. Just a thing.
Never. Always in a mood. Anyway.
No, that's cool. All right.
Yeah.
I'm glad you, as long as you guys are happy, I'm good with that too. All right.
Right. Sunday. That's right. Our happiness should matter, Bernard.
Happiness should matter. Yeah, I agree. Sunday evening. So I thought this one was interesting because I talked to a couple of people outside of, you know, just the normal fan zone chat, and there was like some mix. I was kind of mixed about this one too. Maybe I got to rethink this one though. I mean, this is a band that's been around since 1990. So once again, we're going back into that old school metal era. They listed them as sludge metal, which I'm like, okay, I think more doom metal to me. That's my kind of guess. At least that's my that's the way I perceive them. I think I look at them as more doom than sludge. They're out of New Orleans, Louisiana. And these guys are, I will say this, these guys are heavy. They are definitely heavy. I think this band is particularly like the mosh pit style, right? This is the band you can turn on and you can just go to town on it without a doubt in anyone's mind. The band I'm talking about here is Crowbar. Now, I will say this probably isn't going to be a band that most people would know. That's just kind of like my feel for this. I think you have to be really like into this genre to really know them. I've known of them, you know, I've probably heard a couple of songs from them, but I will say that I've never like really put them on my playlist, to be honest. I will say this, they've had a long history of bands, and their original history started off with, unfortunately, you know, even before they got really known, with, you know, one of their members committing suicide, which I was like, oh my God, that's an awful way to start off, you know, your musical career, and just horrible. Like, how do you pick up from that? You know, when you have something like that, people that you play with on a regular basis. And it's just like, you know, how do you just keep going? But they did, you know, and they and went on forever now at this point. They're active. They're very active. They've had a lot of band members come through their, you know, their band during their time. But let's talk about their discography, though, which is massive. 1991 is when they started. So their first release album was Obedience Through Suffering. Their self-titled album, Crowbar, came out in 93. Time Heals Nothing was 95. Broken Glass, 96. Odd Fellows Rest in 98. Then you had Equilibrium in 2000, Sonic Excess in its purest form, 2001. I mean, you could see like they were cranking out music pretty fast. Like every 2 years or so, even a year in a gap, that's, you know, that's unheard of now. Like what band does that now? No one does. They even still take breaks in between. They take about like 2 to 3 years before they come out of a cycle because they tour so much. That's why.
A private book.
So let's see. Then they took about 4 years before they came out with the next one, which is Life's Blood for the Downtrodden. And then it was another 6 years before they did their next one, which was Sever the Wicked Hand in 2011. Then they had Symmetry in Black in 2014. The Serpent Only Lies. And that one I recognize by title. They were with E1 Music when they did that one in 2016. But then also coming this Friday, March 4th, is their next album. And so I can see like why now Blue Ridge, you know, said, hey, let's get these guys on here, help promote their next album coming up. But their next album that's coming out is going to be called Zero and Below. And that comes out on March the 4th, 2022. So if you're a Crowbar fans, you got new music coming. So, Danny, do you know them at all?
They don't. Apparently, I should, but I don't. This is a band, again, had not heard of, which in and of itself, when you've been around that long, and, you know, I like to consider myself somewhat knowledgeable at times. And so I was really blindsided with this one. So hit Spotify, hit the streaming, and they don't really do it for me, but I can absolutely appreciate where they fit, particularly in a bill where you're going to want a particular stage or a particular genre to be able to bring the heavy, because they definitely do. And so, you know, I'm excited to see a band like that on the bill, kind of like with you with Fear Factory. I don't know that I'm going to be going out of my way to walk toward the stage, but I don't know that I'm going to go out of my way to walk away from them either.
How about you, Todd?
Only thing I know is from Liquid Metal, Octane. I'm not into them too much. Sort of not my thing. Again, I like what they do. They're talented. I listen to it if they came on, but it's not like I'm gonna go out of my way to catch a show. But yeah, why not? I'll check them out. It look like it'd be old and fun. Bunch of old guys out there trying to do it.
Apparently, from what I've heard, they still do it. I know a friend who's like, I have a friend who's here in Orlando who's very into this style of metal, and you know, and he likes them a lot. So I was like, okay, well, you know, that's fine. It's like I'll take your trust. You know, we'll see. Give it a shot. If they're, you know, that's the thing. Like with the schedule and all, we just don't know yet. So it's one of those. I got to see the schedule and see what I can do or not do. Right.
That's exactly right.
Yeah. We'll come through. All right, so that was Crowbar was the last for Sunday. So now we jump into today. Today's announcements, I'll be honest, I was miss on one, hit on the other. The first one that we talked about is going to be the one that was announced earlier today, and I was kind of a miss, but there. Let me talk about the band a little bit first, and I'll give you kind of my opinion as a why. So this is a metalcore band. Well, it's one of, you know, this is probably right in Amanda's wheelhouse now, right? We all know she loves her metalcore. They've been around since 2005. They have 8 full-length albums that released. They're out of the Atlanta, Georgia area. And I think at one point, one of their vocalists lived here in Orlando, because I know friends who were like personal friends with them, you know, and went on tour with them, like to be their photographer and stuff like that. So they've had a lot of success, though. And that's the interesting part about this band, because it's not... I don't find them to be your standard metalcore, not like a Census Fail, not like, I don't know, like a Memphis May Fire. Like this band is kind of more, how do I want to define them? I find them maybe more like that mix of that rap metal style to me. And the band that I'm discussing here is Attila. So Attila, let me go through quickly, like they're just released on records here. Where we go here. So they're listed as being around since what, 2005, I said. So their first album didn't actually come out until 2007. That was called Fallacy. Then there was Soundtrack to a Party in 2008. That one was a big hit. I know that. Like, fans seem to love that album. Rage then came out in 2010, Outlawed in 2011, then About That Life in 2013, Guilty Pleasure in 2014, Chaos in 2016, Villain in 2019, and their most recent album came out just last year, which is known as Closure 2021. Now, musically, I'm hit or miss on them. I will say, from a performance standpoint, these guys are off the chain on stage. Without a doubt, they're fun. They have a very party style atmosphere for live performances. You know, they love to see the mosh pits going. They encourage the circle pits. You know, that's just the type of band they are. I don't know. I'm a kind of miss on this one for me. Like, I wouldn't go out of my way to probably go see it on, you know, at the fest. That's just my personal opinion. I'd say if you've never seen them before, definitely go give them a listen and see if they fit your style of music for sure. And see if you like them. You know, I just don't. That's just me. Danny, what about you? Do you like Attila?
I do. I'm not going to say that they have been a regular rotation for me per se, but they are usually, when I've got on some random mix radio or whatever else, I'm usually cranking them right up for whatever reason. They don't always come to mind with the genre for me. It's a band I've seen them listed on bills before, and I'm always, all right, they obviously know the circuit well enough, and so I gave them a listen, and definitely a band I want to see. I'm glancing through some of these comments that we've got on the live stream, and there's a lot of hype for their energy that they bring. Ron was saying that they try to break records with their crowd surfing, and so
yeah,
to me that there's always an adrenaline rush when you see the conveyor belts begin. So, you know, I'm amped about that, you know, seeing that kind of energy from the fans, to me, coupled with stage energy, I'm sold. That's definitely a band that I want to be able to check out.
Okay. Todd, what about you?
I watch from the sides. I like to watch the pits, what they do. Music, not my thing. They got a big following. Oh, I mean, they've been asked on the Fan Zone. Last 4 years, every year they're right there. Attila. So they brought Attila. So, I mean, great. I love him. I mean, he listens. I mean, they got a following. The pits are massive. I've only seen them at festivals here and there, not really, you know, but the pits, oh, you can feed off that energy. Yeah, I look forward to that one, like Danny.
And that's the funny part is that this is where it gets even funny for me. Like, I am saying, like, they're not my thing, you know. But I've seen them multiple times. I photographed them multiple times. And here I am saying, like, their energy on stage is, I can't remember writing a bad review about them. I don't think I ever have. You know, that's the ironic part. You know, their live performances are solid. I'll give them that. But it's just, when I hear, like, they're going on a tour and announce with this band, I'm just kind of like, I don't know.
Yeah.
But I mean, I will say this. The cool thing is that, you know, you just mentioned that the Fan Zone has been asking for them forever, right? So now John's got him on here. Okay, kudos. I love it for that, you know. And I can't say anything bad about that whatsoever, because it just proves time and time again that John and the team is listening and watching and, you know, paying attention to what the fans want, because that's what this festival is all about for Blue Ridge Rock Festival, right? It's a fan-driven experience. So if Attila was asked for, there you go, fans, you got it. So kudos to that. All right. Now, the last announcement that dropped today. I'm going to try not to go Goo-Goo Gaga for you.
Hard not to.
Yeah. So, I don't know if Todd saw it or not. When we talked about Ginger a couple of days ago, I was just beyond super stoked, because I love Ginger. I love that heavy. I love that sound. And I'm a big fan of female vocalist bands. You know, I'm a big fan of any band that can put a female vocalist on there and they can throw down with metal and whatnot, I'm golden. You know, I mean, I love it. So when this band announced today, I got super excited. I will say this, Courtney called this one before it got announced, because we were chatting earlier today and she mentioned them before they got announced. And I'm like, what the bleep? Like, I just, how do you know these things? So, again, let's talk a little bit about this band. They've been around for a while, since 1994, which makes me go like, what? Like, I didn't think they were around that long, but they have been. They're listed as gothic metal. I could see it. Okay, that's fine. But the here comes the wackadoo part. They're out of Milan, Italy. So we're talking about an international band, heavy metal, good stuff, female vocalist. The band I'm discussing, who I absolutely effing love, is Lacuna Coil. And I could not have been more stoked when I saw this announcement come across on the Blue Ridge Rock Festival page. I was like, oh my God. Yeah, I I mean, what more do I need to say? Let me talk a little bit about this band though, because I just can't. First of all, just so you're aware, for those who don't know, so Lacuna Coil is actually a dual vocalist band. It's a male and a female. Andrea is the male vocalist, Christina is the female vocalist, and both of them together are just incredible on stage live, incredible on recordings. And let me talk a little bit about their discography, because I got a lot of there to go. In a Reverie was their very first album that came out in 1999. They followed that up with Unleashed Memories in 2001, Come Alive in 2002, Karma Code in 2006, Shallow Life in 2009, Dark Adrenaline in 2012, Broken Crown Halo in 2014. I recommend that album, go listen to it. But this one, Delirium in 2016, if you've never heard of Lacuna Coil before, go listen to that album and become a fan. And if you're not, come talk to me, because I'll tell you you're wrong. And then Black Anima came out in 2019. So that was their most recent. Interesting part here that I caught real fast. Let me find this yet again. They had, where was this? I just saw it here. I hate when I find something and then I completely lose it. That just drives me crazy. There it was. So their single Swamped was actually used in the video game of Vampire the Masquerade Bloodlines. And it also appeared on the soundtrack for the movie Resident Evil Apocalypse. So this is a band that is not only just known for their music. I mean, they're known for getting into bigger media too, right? And how often does that happen with rock artists? I mean, let me rephrase. How often does that happen with metal bands? Not as often as you think it does. But I can tell you, like, their live performances are off the chain, and I just love them to death. So, yeah, I'm good. Danny, I'm sorry. I steal thunder.
You did. I mean, I don't know how. I can't help it. I love Coil. How do I one up the fangirl that is Bernard right now? You know, I've seen them a number of times. Never disappoint. Been listening to them for way too long. This is a fantastic ad for the festival. Not just from my own bias and my love for Italy, but I'm absolutely ecstatic to see this name dropped, to be hitting the festival. You know, you don't see them across all these circuits. This is a band that I feel like just kind of came from left field. And I don't know how I went up the fangirling that you did, but I'm over
can't
here.
Help it.
I'm over here in the exact same place. So that is a must for me.
Of course, Lacuna Coil, who doesn't like that, right? No matter what genre of metal are you in, you got to show up. They're amazing. And like I said, if you haven't seen them, show up. You don't like, you can always walk away, but you won't. You're like, oh man, give me more of your, and then you're being
hooked.
Yeah.
I think one of the things that stands out for me is not just this whole dual vocalist thing, because, you know, there's a number of bands that do that and do that well. Mm. But their style of it, not just female and male, but just their entire style, the way they feed off of each other in their songwriting, it's just absolutely incredible. So, yeah, I can't say enough good things about them.
I got to get off here. I get back to work. Right quick, okay. Y'all, no more announcements tonight. They start up again in the morning, 9 o'clock. It's just let y'all go. I got to get back to work. Got to pay that festival ticket somehow.
Todd, thank you for joining us, brother.
I'll be on anytime. Just hit me up. We'll talk about other stuff too, man, about camping and all that. I plan on going down to VR sooner or later to look around, and we'll get a hold of you back then too. Love y'all. Keep up the good work, man. Appreciate everything y'all do.
Yeah, thanks for coming. We'll definitely invite you back.
Take care of yourself, bro. Again.
All right, awesome. Y'all have a good one.
Thanks, Todd. All right. Yeah, I love the fact that Todd was able to join us for this. This was fantastic. I love him. Love him to death. All right.
Let's just recognize him one more time, even though he hasn't completely hung up yet.
Yeah, I know. I don't know what I'm doing.
Do you need me to kick you? Is that what you're saying?
Yeah. So, there we go.
Again, he started this. Hey, he's back.
He's back. Kick me off, dude. I got to get going. They got me all right.
All right. Thank you. Bye.
Again, just a huge shout to Todd, what he's done, Blue Ridge Rock Fest fan zone. You know, he's grown it to over 30,000, closer to 35,000.
35.
Now. And how he and his awesome team of moderators, some of whom are trying to also wave and wonder what in the world's going on these days, but they just do a great job in there, just corralling the insanity that it is between the hints, the hype, the, you know, some of the bickering. What they do is just incredible. But Todd's just the man. I'm ecstatic that he was able to join us. I'm looking forward to picking his brain about some camping tips, and hopefully he'll be joining us again soon.
Yeah, I hope so too. I just absolutely love it. Just absolutely love it. I saw a comment in there. Where was it? Where is my meeting thing? Where was that comment? Christina said it. Where was it? I think she said, you know, I should let it out on my fangirling.
Yes.
And that's okay.
Yes.
Yeah. I will. So I did. So I'm gonna kind of want to fangirl you a little more here. Hang on. Because remember how I said, you know, I was a huge fan of them, but let me if I can find it here. Why is it not Courtney, showing me anything?
Courtney made a comment that we need a camping FAQ live stream. And
we're gonna do that. That is an actual intention. We are gonna do that at some point. I don't know when, but we will arrange that. We will figure that one out. I want to get Todd
all
on
possible
here
with Todd at the helm.
Yeah, like I absolutely want to do that. I think it's a great idea. I think it'll be helpful. So we'll figure that out. All right. Now, so remember I just mentioned that you know, talk about like fangirling, right? About Lacuna Coil. Let me show you why. That's why. So for those who don't know, that's Christina Scott.
You are.
So I actually got to meet them at a festival, and I was beyond thrilled. I mean, she was so nice, and it was just fantastic. And then that's a picture of, this is Marco, and this is Diego. Marco the bassist, Diego is the one of the guitarists, and Diego was like literally photobombing the photo at the time when Marco and I were taking a picture. So, but this is just part of the reason why I love them so much. They're the nicest people. I'll tell you a quick story about this picture. We were at another festival. We were doing our photographing, and the way it was set up from the stage, once we finished, we literally just stepped off to the side, and we were kind of out of view of, you know, the stage, and we weren't near the pit. We weren't even near the fans because there was like some extension for us to exit from there. It was almost like we were like in a sense like side stage, but it really wasn't for that stage. And the majority of us were just standing there looking at our photos. We were watching the rest of the show. When they finished up, Marco, Diego, and I can't remember who the last person was, and I should be ashamed of myself, came walking out off the stage and saw the group of us hanging out there and literally came walking over to talk to us just because they could. I mean, who does that, you know? So we chatted with them for like a good like 10, 15 minutes before they took off and, you know, went back and do what they needed to do. But yeah, they were the nice people, and was just like, I was thrilled. Absolutely thrilled. So yeah, I cannot speak enough about Lacuna Coil and how good they are. Plain something.
You flipped from your picture, but I feel like it was really setting the tone for something that you alluded to last stream.
Oh, I did. I realized I don't have anyone near me, so I got to go run into the other room. So Danny,
go on. This is
going
to be very much like watching Wayne's World, and you've got Garth by himself trying to figure out what to do. So what's happening, everybody? Apparently, I've got this nice green screen next to me of Bernard going and looking for his Grim. So, yeah, I get way too emotional and close to all of these announcements. I'm just absolutely ecstatic to see this festival continue to grow. I appreciate that you guys are all here joining us again and that you keep asking us to come back. So thank you for that. I hope you were actually mouthing that, or you may be having technical difficulties again.
Mouthing that.
So did you find him? Did you find your friend?
I did. Holy crap. We have a lot of people on tonight. Hello, everyone who's joining us. I didn't even realize until I just went to go look at the video. It's awesome. Thank you, guys. Gang, let me see. Guys, I'm sorry. That's bad on me. Thank you, everyone. I got to stop that gender pronunciation there. But in any case, all right. So I'm going to go and embarrass myself because I don't care. And because I do. So let me try to figure out how this started, because there's a story behind this. And it's not even relevant to Blue Ridge. No offense. It's just not. But I think we talked about it, and I said I would bring it on this, the current live stream for the next one. So how long have I had him? I want to say it's back since, it has been, it's back since like 2016, 2017. So Cracker Barrel, every about Halloween season, ends up getting a slew of TYs because they sell TYs like crazy. And if you've never been to a Cracker Barrel before, go and eat one. And that's not a promotion, YouTube, so don't say anything about that. Just saying, because I know they ask. It's not a product placement. Stop. So, in any case, they sell TYs, and around Halloween time, TY always comes out with like a slew of like Halloween themed, you know, Beanie Babies or whatever you want to call them. So I saw this one particular one, and I was like, "Oh my God, I need to have him. I'm going to take him home with me." So I did. And
paid for it though.
Yes, I paid for it. I did not steal it. He was paid for. Yes.
Details matter. Okay.
Details matter. Right. Details matter. So that, like, within, like, you know, and right around that time, I was doing concert photography very early on into the number of years I've been doing this. It's only 5, which is scary now, but I think about it. This is actually year six. And I was going to my very first festival that I was going to photograph. And I decided for some unknown reason to say, you know what? I'm going to bring him with me. And if I could figure out a way to carry him around while I'm at the festival, especially in the photo pits, I'm going to do it. And the reason why is because I said, if one of the artists happens to be looking down and it catches their eye, that means they're looking at me and I got eyes locked on a camera shot, plain and simple. And you know what? It happens. And it works. I end up sticking, like, I wear a badge holder. It was in that picture with me and Christina. I wear a badge holder. I usually put my photo pass in that. And normally what I'll do is I'll stick him and shove him in there. The first time I tried it, he actually popped out. I almost lost him. It's just crazy. But I bring it to every festival and he's always a hit. You know, I have people that, like, you know, when we go see him at festivals, they're like, "Did you bring him?" I'm like, "Really? You want to see him more than me?" I see how this goes. So the name of the TY, his name is Grim. And the reason why he's called Grim is because he is literally a Grim Reaper. And he's cute. Come on, admit it. He's cute.
He is.
Danny's like, I can't even.
I'm like, well, you know, yeah, I would totally be carrying one of them around too.
Well, so he's a I don't know. It's funny. I mean, but it is funny though, because, you know, I'll keep him in my little badge holder. I'll bring, like, if I'm at a festival and I do interviews, I'll have him there, but usually I'll take him off during the interview and I'll hang him on my tripod and just leave him there. And then, you know, after we go and I'll ask the artist, can we do a quick picture together? I'll throw him back on so he's in the photo. So I have tons of photos with him in it, like with me with like Fireball whiskey with, you know, Christina Scabbia. And Christina, this is the funniest part. So Christina, when I first had met her, you know, I went over and introduced myself. She looks at him and goes, "Who's that?" I'm like, "I'm so done." I said, "His name is Grim. He's my festival buddy. I bring him to every festival I go to and he just stays along with me." And she starts scratching his head. I'm like, I'm done. I'm just done. Awesome. So. Yeah, that's Grim. Awesome. Grim's my fest buddy. Odd funny story though. Wait, hang on a second. So odd funny story is that since I've done that, I normally don't bring them to shows. I don't usually bring them to concerts because I don't trust a crowd not to like get them dirty, splashed on, you know, something like that. Like I could bring him to a fest and keep him safe, but bringing him to like a smaller venue where he might pop out and get stomped on 1200 times. No. So the funny part was that our local group of people here, I had other photographers start to buy their own and bring them to shows. I was like, I started a freaking trend.
Look at you being a trendsetter.
That was crazy. When I saw that, I'm like, looking at my friends who have, I'm like, are you kidding me? And they're like, what?
I'm over here, Bernard, and I'm just, I'm wondering, when is the picture book of the Adventures of Grimm going to be released?
Never.
Why are Stacey's laughing over this? She's laughing. Grimm. Memoirs of Bernard and Grimm. I feel like that would be a wonderful time.
I think that'd be a funny book. It could be, but
that's a legacy book for your kids to be able to see.
Yeah, that'd be funny. What Courtney says, his eyes are creepy. His eyes are not creepy. Those look great. What are you talking about? creepy. She says, "I need a voodoo doll." You're so bad,
right?
Christina says she shared us on the fan zone. Thank you. She's fangirling over.
Thank you for that. For those that were commenting, I will say I think I saw our viewers peak at close to 50. So there was a lot of people that were excited to see Todd. Apparently we're not as good. That's okay.
Yeah, apparently not. Apparently I need Todd to come on.
Todd's been doing this a lot longer. And so he too is a trendsetter.
It's all right. It's all good. That's fine. So any case, but yeah, that's Grimm. So he came to Blue Ridge last year. He was there. And
you introduced me.
This was the sad part. And this is what I said with the way it was set up last year. So a lot of the for those who don't know, a lot of the photographers ended up sticking to backstage, which is not normally things that we do because normally we're not allowed, in a sense, backstage. Blue Ridge security and staff seemed perfectly fine with us walking around the back way because, believe it or not, it was just easier to get from stage to stage, like from where our media area was. Like for me, from media area, I could just jump out and be at URW in like 3 minutes, as opposed to having to walk around the outside through the fans and all the way around, because that would have taken me like 10 to 15 with the amount of people that were there. So, but the sad part to me is that one of the things I always love about is of having Grimm with me too, is when I connect with fans and groups when I'm doing festivals, and getting people to recognize me because of him, you know, because otherwise I'm just a face in a crowd, you know, but he stands out. So hopefully maybe this year I'll get to connect to more of the fan zone group, you know, and if you see me walking around with Grimm, you'll know it's me, and then come over and say hi, please do. Cause I love to talk to people. We'll do selfies. I'm okay with that. You know, maybe Danny will too. Who knows? You know, like the way Danny was sharing out selfies of everyone he met at Blue Ridge, except for mine.
Again, I don't think you actually ever sent me that.
Did you ask?
Why would I have to do that?
Because I tagged you on it when I originally posted it last year.
It'd be a little creepy if I'm just there saving that picture.
Why? What's creepy about that? It was a picture of us. I shouldn't be creepy. We're pals. We're buds.
We are. That was a good time. I do appreciate you sharing that. And no problem.
Happy to.
I will say festivals in particular, concerts, yes, but festivals in particular, the opportunity to work your way through a crowd and meet people along the way, even these 20-second quick conversations that you can get in, it adds to the experience exponentially.
Yeah.
And that to me is just... To me, that's one of the main reasons I do festivals. That's one of the best things I've loved about Blue Ridge, the couple from when I went in 2019, when I went last year, the conversations with everybody along the way just made it that much cooler. So yeah. I'm hopeful that when time requires it and I can haul myself behind the stages to dodge back and forth, I can. But I also hope that there will be opportunity to actually come and meet a lot of people this year.
I hope so too. That's one of the things that made me sad about last year is just the setup wasn't ideal for us. as media to go out in that crowd to meet people. Just, it was, you know, it just to get from stage to stage. Like, we're short on time for us. That's the hard part. You know, with the, when we get the schedule, like, we only get three songs of the first set. And some of us are like trying to squeeze in like five sets that are all in the same, like 10 to 15 minute time block, you know, shoot a song and leave, shoot a song and leave. That wasn't me. I wasn't that crazy, but I know people who did it. So it was harder for us to really connect with fans, you know, during that time frame. Now, I will say I did connect with artists when I had the chance to, you know, I made my way down to a lot of the rising talent artists when I had the chance to say hi and, you know, meet and see their sets and shoot their sets and stuff. So that was great. I was glad I was able to do that. I hope this year I'll get to come and hopefully, you know, hope for approval that I'll get to see, you know, more of the fans in the fan zone and connect with everyone there, and especially connect with people who've been watching us. So, you know, that would be cool.
We've still got a few viewers that are hanging with us right now. And so I'm going to put this out there, and maybe somebody will hold us accountable for it. But I think we should do a contest, Bernard, of who's going to get more selfies with fans over the course of the weekend. I think we could have some fun. But then we also have to see how many of them will come back and tag themselves in our photos.
Right.
I think that'd be a fun experience.
That would be a very interesting,
It would be.
It would be.
So just something to chew on.
I'll think about that one.
I will say I would likely win because I can at least cut off a conversation when I need to.
I can't.
I know, honestly,
what is that, a hint? Is that what you're trying to tell me?
No, I'm good at the moment. Thank you. I think it'd be a great opportunity.
I think it'd be fun. I think it'd be fun too. I do. Hang on. So I'm just browsing through some of the comments. Somebody said something funny. I can't see like all the comments, which is weird. You know, like it's not showing me like everything from like, you know, 30 minutes ago when I'm looking at, you know, my own video here. But I saw, I think it was Aiden who said it. Or it might've been Brian, one of the two, Brian is on, about, I must be dual monitoring or I had a teleprompter. I don't. What I do when I'm going through the band stuff, I'm usually like digging out stuff from online on the internet. And I'm just looking at my details with my browser while I'm staring at the camera. So it makes it look like I'm looking at the video, but I'm not. Because I know as long as I'm looking here, I'm talking straight to you guys and you can see me. So I don't use a second monitor, teleprompter, or anything like that. I just use my browser and pay attention to my webcam. Plain and simple. Easy enough. It works. So.
Well, here I am feeling like crap because like half of this live screen, you know, I'm just looking at this other screen like, okay, well, I could actually read this. My poor eyes are, we're good. So I'm not paying attention to you, Bernard. I'm not paying attention to any of our 12 viewers. I am just not nearly as talented. So that's what you get.
Yeah, it's all good. And thank you, Michael. We appreciate it. We appreciate your comment. I'll be honest, a lot of the info I just Google, you know, it just, there's a lot of artists that who have been announced I've had personal experiences with because I've either photographed them before, I've just known about them forever and a day, you know, I've done research on stuff, but I mean, a lot of my information, I just pull from Google and just find the points I want to talk about. And usually, like, I think the good overview of you could see that we've talked about is usually, you know, little history, discography, and if they're albums I know, and then just about their style of music. And if I've known them because I've seen them or, you know, I've done photographing them before, I want to talk a little bit about that and what I experienced with them. So I think it's helpful. At least I hope it's helpful. If you guys are coming and enjoying us, thank you. We appreciate that. So what else do we have? I don't know. Dane, you got anything else for tonight?
You know, I think we hit the highlights. We had a good number of announcements. We got however many more at this point. You know what, that is something that I think we should end on, okay? So we have only changed Blue Ridge Math 16 times so far. So let's go ahead and change Blue Ridge Math one more time.
Yes.
In one of these recent announcements, and don't ask me which one, the number 171 popped up. And so we questioned it because it was 159 artists and it was 169 artists. And I've been corrected no less than 12 times alone. So when we saw 171, we're both scratching our heads. What in the world is going on? And we did receive a confirmation that that is accurate. At last count, again, Blue Ridge Math, just hang with us, 171 artists across the 4.5 days of rock and roll. And I'm just, I don't even know what to do with that. 171 artists. This is going to be unreal.
And that, I'm pretty sure, is including the club experience artists as well in that group.
And the pre-party.
Yes.
So from Wednesday night, the camping exclusive pre-party, the club experience over 3 nights, and 4 days of rock and roll. 171 artists. That's huge.
It's that's crazy to me. It's so crazy. The oh, by the way, that that number that came out was with Crowbar's announcement, because I went and looked, because, you know, that's what I do. So Crowbar is the one that 171 came up. I pointed it out to Danny, and Danny's like, what are you talking about? And I screenshot it, circled it, shoved it in his face and said this. And he's like, I'll find out. So that's where it came
from.
So
we did.
Yeah, so we did. So yeah, that's the official. It's 171 artists on the bill, and go count it yourself on the, yeah. And just as a reminder, right? So there's two places you want to get your artist announcement lineup details, right? The announcements primarily over at the Blue Ridge Rock Festival Facebook page. That's where you're going to find usually the announcements. They also come out on Instagram. They also come out on Twitter. Amanda confirmed that with me the other day. And then the actual lineup details, you want to see the bands like who are listed, go to the BlueRidgeRockFest.com /lineup and go find the listing there. So one of the things to point out in these write-ups that Jonathan had pointed out, that there was still, out of the top 40 bands, at least however they ranked them, and I don't know how they did, out of the top 40 bands, only 3 have been announced so far. So we still have 37 more to go. I'd like to see one in the top 10 sometime this week. That would be nice. That would be awesome if we could. Hint, hint, nudge, nudge. Just saying. Any case. So please keep your eyes out there. You know, those announcements are coming out daily right now. And when you have 171 to go, we're going to be doing this for weeks, just so you're aware.
Let's get comfy. Let's keep on going.
Yeah, we'll keep on going. So, and just so everyone, before anyone asks, we may, I think maybe what Danny and I will do is start doing these maybe every other day. So we'll have like 6 artists to talk about primarily, maybe 5 or 6. Unless like it's someone big that I just basically go and tell Danny, we got to talk about this tonight. You know, otherwise we'll probably do them every other day. So our next one will probably be on Wednesday. We'll probably try to shoot maybe the same time frame, 7:30.
Maybe be a little later on Wednesday.
Why?
I have a spouse who I love dearly, and I need to say yes, yes, dear, please, whatever you need. So if we do Wednesday, it'll be a little bit later. If we do Thursday, it'll be a little earlier. Either way, we will be back with plenty to talk about.
Yeah, we'll always be back. So, but once again, thank you everyone for watching. Thank you for supporting us. We appreciate it. Share the, you know, when you see these come out, please share this out. I love to see this thing grow even bigger. We love the conversation. You know, we love the comments. We love the interactions. You know, we love the opinions. So keep bringing them on. And, you know, we'll see. And if there's, like you said, if there's anything specific that you'd like us to talk about outside of the artist announcements, let us know. You can message the Photo Book Facebook page. You can message me directly, message Danny or the Threshold Facebook page, you know, however you want to work it, but contact us and let us know. You know, we're happy to talk about whatever when it comes to the Blue Ridge Rock Festival. We're supporting them as much as we can. And this is just part of that support that we give. So, but the artist announcements right now, because they're just delving them out. Now we're just going to keep talking about them until somebody tells us to stop. So with that in mind,
even
then we'll keep on talking about it. Right. So, thank you again, everyone. We appreciate your time and, you joining us today, and we will, more than likely talk to you on Wednesday, and we'll drop the announcements, you know, in the fan zone and on the photo pit page and on the threshold page once we know and confirm times. But we'll probably catch you in about 2 days. All right. Thanks, everyone. Take care.
Y'all. Everyone have a great night.